earlier.
Darryl, the part of your book where you in the offensive zone, we have a F3 high and two low attackers, and you're numbered 1, 2, 3, and then your defense are numbered 4, 5, and you had them shifting shapes, and I was thinking, yeah, number 4 could be number 1. They're going to trade off, and there's a constant flow and movement relative to space available, space being created, and reading off one another. This is where I feel the NHL has made the biggest jumps in terms of interchange of positions in a coordinated, cooperative way that's really hard to defend. And I believe, working with the girls I'm watching in U15 and U18 level, especially at the U18 AAA level, they are capable of doing everything you describe in your book. I have no doubt about it. And just the fact you've referred to two triangles in the offensive zone and the movement pattern in that chapter of the book, that's something that I'm going to share with a number of coaches who have players that have the skill sets and the intelligence now to go to that level. So I wonder if you could elaborate on that, and you know the part we're talking about, I think.
Yeah, like, again, it's trying to, like, one of my big pet peeves in the offensive zone at every level is that we all say we want a F3, but then we tell the D, like, if the F3 is not there, then you can't engage. What do you mean the F3 is not there? That F3 is going to be there, because as soon as that F3 leaves, we now need a new F3 that's rotating up into that position and taking that position. So if we, in my mind, having in the offensive zone, your F3 as the connective tissue between the two triangles, a low triangle and a high triangle, and you say like F3 is there no matter what, that you don't need to worry about it. And it doesn't have to be the same kids standing there in the F3 spot. We want them rotating. And they, when they come down, the next person comes in. What it does is allow your defenseman to read the play and be more active. How many times does a defenseman get beat on a pinch because they hesitated? That's pretty much the number one reason why a defenseman gets beat on a pinch. It's one of two reasons. Either A, they shouldn't have left in the first place because it was not a play that had much of a percentage to win that thing. Like, there was no way that the conditions of that play required a pinch. So that was a bad decision. That's one. Or they hesitated and then they went. And in that hesitation, that was the time that was needed for the puck carrier to get the puck and beat the pinch. A lot of those hesitations are due to the fact that they are not trusting that an F3 is actually there. So I'm saying, on our team, you don't need to worry about it. F3 is there. And if you get beat on the pinch on the latter, not the former, where sometimes you can pinch and it's just a poor decision based on the play and there's no business for you even trying to do such a thing, fair enough. Let's set that aside. If it is a decision and there is an opportunity for you to go in and activate and get involved, whether it's a pinch or activating down the wall or getting in these different spaces, if there's an opportunity for you to do that, well, then you should do it. But we don't need you to hesitate because you're looking to try to see, well, is F3 here to help me? No, F3 is going to be there because that is what we do. And I think the adherence of F3 and making that a major part of the way in which you teach the shape, and that's a bit of a non-negotiable, we have F3 and that's it, I think that goes a long way to helping everyone engage and reduce a lot of these hesitations. And that's why to talk about those two triangles and how they're connected by that F3. And what I'm suggesting is F3 is there. It's not even a question. They're there. They're rotating up. And they're coming up there with speed and purpose.
Okay, Darryl, I want to make the point. I really believe that there's sort of a progression of teaching to pinch or not to pinch. Oh, pinch the far side only. Don't pinch the overload side. But I have just learned recently, and it was last year or 2 years ago working with Tom, if the defensemen follow up, then don't play on the blue line. Play inside the blue line. On the puck side, you're at the ringette line. F3 will be there. If you're not at the ringette line on the strong side, F3 won't see you. And the idea of F3 is going to be
I think most is
dependent on the D being activated sooner and feeling comfortable with it. I think it's a no-brainer. You call it pinching. I'd say activating both sides. Pinching was sort of like a finished attack in our day. But I'm just curious about that and your thoughts. But it's something I've done with the U13, 15 on the bench. Stress that teeter-totter in terms of support. When you're coming down or pinching, the other one's pulling out half-rank width apart, back and forth. And I found it's simple thinking for them if we let them do it.
Use the word, you know, it creates an immediate game connotation where everyone can know what we're talking about. But I think that the defensemen in general play way too high in the zone. And many of them are at the blue line and standing still at the blue line. Entirely too much for me. I really like the D to be moving. We used to call it surfing, and you know, where they're actively moving. They come down to the ringette line. They're there. Then as we get the puck, then they start to pull back and use the space between the ringette line and the blue line. They use that space and create it, and it allows them to stay in motion. I also think that you don't need to be, you know, if your players have that kind of movement, you're not really pinching like the way we used to describe it, where the kid was coming from a ways away. It is a true activation, but the activation started well before that decision. They were already moving into those spaces, and they're in coordination with the play, and they're in coordination with that F3. So where I was trying to go in explaining it, was that those two triangles are connected. And this is not like new stuff. Like we've been talking about two triangles for decades now. It's not really rocket science. It's more the idea of the connectivity and how important that F3 actually is, and that maybe we should adhere to that more and then activate these D in a much more purposeful way earlier and have them moving much earlier so that they could attack down, they can surf across, they can, if we lose the puck, they can weak side fold, they can work it with in coordination with the now defensive forwards who are in the offensive zone, their defensive forwards trying to get the puck back.
I'm really curious. We've got Hal on and Jordan. In terms of engaging the defense and them being involved in attacks, to what degree at your levels, Hal and Jordan, are we still playing 2-3 hockey, three forwards, 2D, or are we letting them interchange and people adapt at your levels? Are they there yet, Hal?
I think the idea is there. Hello, everybody. Sorry, I'm late. I think the issue that I see is we got D that want to grab a puck and they want to play forward rather than be sort of integrate, rather than head manning it and then coming up underneath and creating tighter spaces or where there's turnovers. So they're encouraged to be very offensive, but that means get the puck and skate it themselves. And so, but that's manageable. So I personally, I think we're moving pretty quickly here, whether it's youth hockey, high school hockey, Darryl, I'm in Minnesota, into five guys on offense, five guys on defense. Everybody's involved, and I've been for many years trying to get those defensemen off the blue line and get them closer to the top of the circles. Just for me, it's just about compressing the space that we're playing in, whether it's offensively, but also when there's a turnover. We've got an opportunity to sort of engage the other team much quicker that way, not let them get ahead of speed and get up and going. So I don't know, Jordan, what are you seeing?
Well, I think much the same as what you're talking about, Hal, with the ultimate goal being, five on offense, five on defense. One of the things we see lots of is similar in that you'll have defense leading the rush rather than joining the rush. And lots of times I talk with the D about that in thinking that if we want to play fast, there are times for the D to lead the rush, but because the opportunity may present itself. But if we truly want to play fast, it should be joining the rush. And in that you're looking at the words I use are pass and play, not pass and watch. You made that great pass and you watched the puck go up the ice, right? Pass and play, pass the puck. And then really what Darryl's been talking about is that piece of making sure that playing off the puck, like the importance of that. And I think that where we are now with the defense skating the game so well that it is becoming more of a five attack or trying to get attacking with four or five. We do ourselves a disservice as well, though. We use labels still. And like you'll hear the label of a stay-at-home defenseman and that sort of thing. Well, my dad says I'm a stay-at-home defenseman. And you're going, well then stay at home.
Stay like, home.
come and be part of the offense. Be part of the fun, It's that piece. So it's we got to make sure that we're all talking the same vocabulary and that we're all pulling in the same direction that way. I go back to something you said a while ago, Hal, about the shots from the point and that players saying, what do you mean? You don't want me to score from the point? No, we want to score. It's knowing how we are generating the offense. And so I think that it's a big piece that having these D activated at all times, offensive zone, defensive zone, always looking for opportunities to generate offense because offense is fun.
Jordan, in Darryl's book, and Darryl, this is the thing that I have to admit, I've never thought of, never heard of, but it's brilliant. You talk about defensive zone play offensively. It's your zone, but you're already anticipating what's happening to break out and attack, that transition moment. So where everybody sort of focuses on protect the house and lock down and just stay, your thinking in that chapter is fairly advanced. And Jordan, in keeping with that, when possession's gained, the best pass option is the weak side D. And Darryl, I go back to Ella analyzing that one shift of hers where she was the breakout forward on the wall, and she knew it. Simply, she just explained it. I did it. And when we're saying, well, gosh, this is too complex, I'm saying, no, it isn't, at a very young age. So you can hear these men here. Darryl, we're getting this information from you. They're applying it every day at their practices. They're innovating with it. And I'm really in a great position to sit back and watch it all happen, just observing it. But that idea of thinking ahead in your own zone without the puck, you don't have it yet. Can you elaborate on that and then get it into the attack where there's that interchange? It's not the forwards only. Go ahead, Darryl.
The idea is that we only really want to defend for the least amount of time possible. The purpose of defending is to get the puck back. And then once we get the puck back, we need to have an eye forward of where we're trying to go so that we can begin to formulate an attack that's intelligent and uses multiple people and gets us in a place.